Hi, everyone. I'm Olga Viaverde, and welcome to our Palm Beach County Back to School Town Hall. As this school year winds down for the winter break, many parents, caregivers, and educators are breathing a collective sigh of relief. We got through the first few months with in-person classes for some and continuing online education for others. And today, we have a couple of fantastic guests to help us look back and more importantly, look ahead to the new year. Joining us today is Keith Oswald, Deputy Superintendent and Chief of Schools at the School District of Palm Beach County. And also joining Keith is Dr. Scarlett Constant, pediatrician at Baptist Health South Florida. We welcome both of you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for joining us. Now, before we get into our discussion today, I just want to remind our viewers and everyone watching out there that if you have any questions, any concerns, send them into the comments section below, and we're going to get to them throughout our live session. But let's get started. Keith, I'd like to start with you. So, big question, how did it go? In-person classes for a few months, and as the week progressed, what grade would you give it?
Yeah, I'd give us probably a B plus. So a lot changed. So the first few weeks we opened up, we were completely distance learning. And then shortly after that, we did open up brick and mortar. So once we prepared all of our technology needs for our family, we worked a lot on Wi-Fi connection and laptops so we could get to a one-to-one device. A lot of it was around teacher development. So, you know, the hard piece was continue to work through is around that simultaneous teaching. Those parents are choosing their kids, keep their kids in distance learning while at the same time teaching those kids who are in brick and mortar. So we have probably the majority of our teachers that are doing both at the same time. So student engagement tends to be an area of struggle for our teachers to keep kids engaged for those who are in distance learning. So fortunately, when it comes to the COVID issue, what we're learning from our Department of Health is that transmission of COVID is not happening on our school campuses outside of mm-hmm. a couple of athletic events. So the mitigation strategies we put in place regarding face coverings, increased sanitization, social distancing is paying mm-hmm. off. And so, you know, many of our parents, yeah.
And I know a lot of parents had feared that aspect of sending their kids to school and the possibility of, you know, either getting or spreading COVID. Dr. Constant, let's piggyback on what Keith said. There was a lot of concern. I think research is now showing it's not what we thought. Tell us what you've learned and what you've seen.
Exactly. What we've seen in the office is just to support what Keith said, is absolutely there have been isolated cases of COVID positive patients in the schools, and they are usually getting it on the weekends with the family, with outside events. There has not been spread within the school. For example, the classes are notified that there is a patient that's COVID positive, and as of yet, we have not seen that those classrooms have actually experienced a spread. These are totally isolated incidences, which has been great. Unfortunately, on the flip side, this is athletics is not included. It's absolutely excluded. We've seen spread within the teams and athletic events.
And we're going to talk about athletics and PE in just a couple minutes. Keith, I still want to stay on the kids going back to school. How was it seeing them interact with the teachers, administrators? I mean, it must have been fantastic. How did they do? Were they excited?
Yeah. Oh, my God. It was so nice to be open for brick and mortar. I've been to so many schools and so many classrooms, and the kids, even though they're wearing a face mask, and even though they're socially distanced, they're just so excited to be back into a regular school building. It's quite refreshing. Even though things don't look the same, they're not, you know, they're a lot different. They're glad to be back. You know, right now we're at about 45% of our families who have chosen to return back to brick and mortar. There is great differences from one school to the next. We really want to get more of our families back in brick and mortar, especially for those kids who are not doing well academically in a distance learning environment. So that's really our big push right now, is to get more of our families to come back where they feel comfortable and safe to do so.
And I think some ways of making them more comfortable, Keith, is regarding testing. And the Palm Beach County Schools have an innovative program I was reading here using the rapid tests. I think if you share that with parents, they may say, hey, I might send my daughter or son. Tell us about that rapid test.
Yeah, so we're fortunate in Palm Beach County that we have the healthcare district who really helps supports us with our school nurses. So we have a school nurse in every one of our schools, which is just fantastic. That also helps in our steps moving forward. So if someone does show any symptoms of COVID, they're quickly sent to our school nurse, and they quickly work with a school administrator. They quickly assess of whether or not that student needs to be sent home or if they can return back to class. And if they're sent home, we work with our families to go and have them tested or follow up and monitor their child till they're symptom-free. What just changed recently, thanks to the governor and that work of getting these rapid antigen tests, is that we're actually doing the 15-minute rapid antigen test right on our school campuses. So a student who does show those symptoms, a nurse is assessing that, and they're administering. We just started it. Right now, the majority of those results are coming out negative. However, we have had a few of those that have come out positive. So by doing so, we're able to quickly begin contact tracing, quickly begin, you know, those additional strategies to reduce risk of anybody else contacting COVID, and obviously getting that student off campus.
Absolutely. Dr. Constant, I wanted to ask you in terms of what you're seeing with kids going back to school. I can only imagine it's helping them. We've talked so much about it in the past, you and I, about loneliness, their mental health. It's been a tough time. And also having them back in school, their parents' mental health as well. Share that with us if you don't mind.
Absolutely. So we've seen a huge increase in just enthusiasm to go back to school. The kids are so excited. They're very happy to see their friends again. Parents are back at work, and there's a lot more of a schedule in place, so everyone just feels a lot better. The biggest concern is that a lot of these, you know, the kids are usually in a hybrid type. At least here in Dade County, they have a hybrid schedule. So that has been a little bit difficult as far as maybe not being sent to school at the same time as your friends are, or just having to be home for certain days. And of course, them being sent home when there happen to be positive cases in class. So that does throw off the schedule a little bit. But from what I've heard overall and what I've seen in the office is that the kids are really enthusiastic about being back in campus and being at school with their teachers. So it has been great.
I can only imagine. Again, I just want to remind anyone watching out there, our viewers, if you have a question for Keith or Dr. Scarlett Constant, please give us, a little, not a ring, I was going to actually say to call us, but no, put your question in the comments below and we'll get to them throughout our next half hour with this live town hall. Keith, speaking of mental health programs that are in place in the schools, can you share some that are in place now for parents to know about?
Yeah, again, very fortunate here in Palm Beach County. Thanks for the voters. You know, over a year ago, we approved a full millage increase here, and millions of dollars went into mental behavioral health. So on every one of our school campuses, you know, we're all used to having those school counselors on campuses. We still have those available to support our students. But in addition to that, we also have a mental behavioral health professional that is available on every one of our campuses. These are district employees that have a background in mental and behavioral health to provide that additional type of support and services. Also, on top of that, we also have what we call co-located services. And what that is are agencies that exist in Palm Beach County that do more of that deeper tier support for students who are struggling with some deeper issues. Those are on about 100 of our campuses and available to our families as well. So if your child's experienced any type of challenge, we have a comprehensive supportive team at every one of our school campuses to support mental and behavioral health. It's pretty exciting. I often want to share the data that people say that people won't reach out for mental health services. We found the exact opposite when we put the services right on our school campuses. So having these agencies that do deeper support work for families, they are going to use them. They trust our schools. They do want to help their children. And, you know, the services are getting used left and right. Our school principals are excited to have a comprehensive supportive team to support our families. And it just continues. And then one more piece I do have to say, if we have a kid who's in crisis and needs immediate support, we also expanded our support to have 3 crisis teams that can go out to a school campus immediately to support a child.
And Keith, Dr. Constant had mentioned just a few minutes ago regarding sports. I am such an advocate when it comes to school sports. I think it's so important in our children's lives. So let's talk about sports in the new year in Palm Beach County and PE as well, physical education. That was my favorite, by the way.
Yeah, so sports, oh boy. That's a tough one. I mean, the kids are obviously completely excited to be able to get back out on a football field or playing a volleyball game, which is exciting, and they need that outlet and exercise. Unfortunately, we have seen increases in number of COVID cases in a number of our events, and unfortunately, we had to cancel a number of football games, volleyball games, et cetera, because of COVID. In addition, we've seen some transmission that have happened on some of our teams through sports. So we're really working with our athletic directors, our coaches, to really, again, work on mitigation strategies. As soon as we know of a case, we completely shut down, you know, practices so that we can go through that quarantine and that isolation period so we can get the kids back into practicing once it's safe to do so. With PE on our school campuses during the day, it's going fantastic. You know, they're getting into more exercising and those type of things, events, and our PE teachers are able to really do that in a socially distanced way so that kids are safe and that we're not transmitting any COVID.
And Dr. Constant, that makes me so happy because I've been driving by schools here in Dade and looking at the fields, and there's no children. And I always hear the voices, and I see them playing kickball, softball, you name it. So the fact that PE is going well, isn't that important? And talk to us about parents who've told you, I really want my kids to go out there and do some exercise.
Right, absolutely. PE has been fantastic because you're able to practice, do drills, exercise. I mean, you can really do a lot without, you know, with social distancing. So PE has been very successful. The kids are super happy, and you're kind of going back to that old school PE model with the pull-ups and the push-ups and the sit-ups and everything. So I think that's great. We've been very happy. The kids have been happy, and I've seen a lot of my patients actually coming back, you know, that have lost weight, that look great, and that feel great. So I'm excited about PE. Unfortunately, like Keith said, absolutely the team sports has been a source of concern in a lot of the schools and in the community.
And I want to focus on parents with kids with special needs. They have been through a lot as well in this pandemic. And in fact, I got a viewer question that I want to get to immediately from Alex. Okay. And she wants to send her special needs child back to school, but she is worried about the virus because her son isn't 100% healthy. Dr. Constant, can you chime in on her concern, please?
Absolutely. You know, it depends. You have to evaluate your situation and the school and the way they've been handling the cases at their school and the way their classrooms are set up. And a lot of schools have been amazing. They have a small class, they have a small student body. They're washing down the tables. The children are wearing masks. And even with special needs, it's been the same way. Everything has been, you know, again, depending on the school you go to and if you feel comfortable, they're doing great and they're thriving. And a lot of schools have been allowing the therapists to come back into the classroom and offer the therapy in the classroom during school hours. So if that's a possibility for you, Alex, I think that would be great for your child.
Absolutely. And Alex, thank you for writing in. Again, if you have any concerns, just like Alex did, please just send in your questions in the comment section below, and we will get to them as soon as possible. Keith, I want to piggyback on the special needs families. Again, they've been hit hard. How are these kids reacting to going back to school? And for parents who are a little bit worried, like Alex is, what would you say?
Yeah, their fears are real. And, you know, thank you, Dr. Constant, for the shout out about our schools and what we've been doing. And we understand their concerns. And as Dr. Constant said, if you come into the schools and see what we've done in our special needs classrooms, in many of them, we've ordered additional PPE. So in some cases, we'll have face coverings that are completely go over the entire head so that we can increase the safety for employees, but also depending on, you know, a potential disability a child may have, we can increase the type of PPE that's available for them as well. Also, with social distancing, you know, is a priority. You know, we monitor the number of classrooms in the entire county on a weekly basis to see how many are less than 6 feet. And I'm pleased to share that there's only been a handful of cases where that's occurring. And when that's occurring, it's really around five and a half feet. So we've been able to maintain that social distancing much more so. So I think if you come to the school, if you call the principal and ask about the additional safety precautions that we're taking to ensure that, you know, transmission is reduced, I'm sure that you'll be happy and want to get your child back into schools.
Fantastic. Dr. Constant, I also believe it's important to have a strong focus on providing resources for underserved populations in our community. Can you give us some insight, or what you're hearing for that matter, into what families may be going through right now in terms of access to education? Technology is a big thing. Some people don't have much access. Keith, I'm going to follow up with you on that one. But Dr. Constant, first you.
Right. So what I've seen actually in our community patients is that for those families that do not have access, that find it very difficult, they have all reluctantly sent their kids back to school. And, you know, it's worked out well in that way. And like I said, the schools have been very well prepared. And so the families are able to send their children. But what people forget is that when you do have an incident or there is a COVID scare and everyone has to go home, that's where the problems lie. Number one, with access to technology, but number two, with parents that are not able to take off from work to be home with their kids. These are parents that don't get those days off for a COVID scare or possible quarantine. And that has been a source of strain in the somewhat marginalized community.
And Keith, I know we've been talking a lot about the in-person, but there's still obviously lots of families that have chosen to keep their children home, which I can completely understand. Let's talk about what Palm Beach County schools are doing in terms of access to technology and helping these families out so that their children can get a great education starting in the new year. A new year!
A new year. We're all looking forward to that, right? So, oh my God, when it comes to technology, we have done so much here in Palm Beach County, and I have to do a shout out to all the community partners who stepped up to donate devices, donate money. So one, you know, we're at a one-to-one for a device. So every child, it has access to a laptop, a Chromebook. So if your child doesn't have one, we have one available. So we ordered 85,000 additional, actually about 110,000 additional devices so that we could get to a one-to-one in Palm Beach County. The other big issue that we learned and we saw was the access to internet, right? So we can't do that without that piece. So again, through our community partners, and there's so many to mention, Education Foundation, who really mobilized our business community. We ordered, we paid for Comcast Wi-Fi for families, and if Comcast wasn't in an area that served, we also bought hotspots and device for many of our communities that don't have. So through T-Mobile and others, we were able to provide those families who needed internet access those devices. And if they're still having trouble, please let us know. We've done home visits where we couldn't get, the hotspot wasn't working, Comcast didn't serve, to we problem solve so that there could be internet in that home. So we're gonna continue to do that throughout this, unfortunately, this challenge that we face. So, but if anybody needs a device or needs support, please contact your school principal so that they can get you hooked up.
So again, they should contact the school principal from the school, call them there, yeah, and they will facilitate this for them.
Absolutely, 100%.
That's great. That's such wonderful things that we do in this country for the children. As we're wrapping up our discussion, and we've only got a couple minutes left, Dr. Constant, any final words of advice for parents out there who are still maybe afraid of sending their kids back to school, who are hopeful for 2021, as I am, and I'm sure everyone out there is? Any last words of advice?
Yes. So this is a question that is asked of me on a daily basis. And, you know, I tell the parents, you know, have faith in your school system, have faith in your teachers. They're doing a wonderful job. They are also putting themselves on the line and putting themselves at risk. So trust them. You know, it's been going wonderfully in our community. We are not seeing transmission within the school. And honestly, if you think about it, like another reassuring factor is that as a pediatrician, I'm not seeing any kids with the flu. I'm not seeing cough, colds, runny noses. I haven't seen an ear infection, honestly, since the beginning of last year around January. I mean, that alone speaks volumes, that the kids are safe. They're safe from not only COVID, but they've truly been safe from our regular common illnesses around this time.
Amen. So that's fantastic news to hear. That's great. And so far, my kids, hold on, let's knock on wood. Everything is good so far. Keith, any final words of advice? I have about a minute left for you, darling.
Yeah, so one thing I'd like to say, if your child is struggling in distance learning, and we unfortunately have seen an increased number of students who are not passing their coursework or struggling with reading or math, you know, please, please consider coming back to brick and mortar. We're going to be sending out information on January 4th for our parents to, you know, indicate how they want to have their child, whether they want them in brick and mortar again or to stay in distance learning. But one thing we learned from the executive order from our governor and our commissioner is that if you're struggling, we need to really have you back in on our school campuses. So please consider that. We know in the end it's about what's safe for your family, but we're here to welcome you back to brick and mortar.
What a great discussion, and it's so hopeful, which is such a fabulous way to end. I want to thank you both for your time, Keith Oswald and Dr. Scarlett Constant. Do appreciate it because I know how busy you are.
Thank you
for having us. Thank you.
No, thank you. God bless you both. And by the way, stay tuned for our Broward County Town Hall. That was Palm Beach. Now we're going to turn to Broward County Town Hall in just a couple of minutes. So stay tuned for that. And again, thanks for tuning into this Palm Beach County Town Hall. And of course, thank you as always for supporting South Florida PBS and the Health Channel. We'll see you in a couple minutes.
When you've got a question about your health, you need answers you can count on. So ask Hannah.
It's one of the most common questions people ask me. How can I get rid of my back pain?
Get easy to understand explanations of the most common medical conditions. It's a video library at your fingertips covering hundreds of medical conditions.
Figuring out what is causing your high PSA level is very important in determining if and what kind of treatment you may need.
You'll also find hundreds of online articles. Ask Hannah is a multi-platform service that delivers personalized health information. That means you can even chat with a health advisor via text in real time for free. You can count on them to respond to every question.
Because no question should ever go unanswered.
So next time you're looking for answers about your health, ask your friend in the know.
Remember, if you don't know where to start, ask Hannah.
All you need is your cell phone, tablet, or your computer. So the first thing you do is you go to allhealthtv.com, and that's our website, and you'll notice immediately Ask Hannah. You click on Ask Hannah, and she pops up. You'll see she's available Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. So you scroll down, and you're gonna click here to start the chat. Once you start the chat, you're gonna notice that she gives you all these topics that you can ask about. I'm just gonna read a few. Anxiety, diabetes, obesity, heart conditions, high blood pressure. I'm gonna scroll a little bit lower because my question is really something else. I'm gonna fill in that I'm a female and 53 years old. Once I do that, I am ready to start my chat with Hannah. And here's my question for her. I am an avid runner and my knees are hurting. What could it be? Once I pose my question, I just click away and Hannah starts reading it, and I'm going to wait for her reply. And here's Hannah's response. She's telling me that knee pain is a common symptom in people of all ages. It may start suddenly, often after an injury or exercise. There's some more information for me to read. And on top of that, Hannah provides me with a video to watch from the Health Channel on knee pain and runner's knee. So not only is she giving me vital information to read, but also a video to watch. And don't forget, you can get the same response, which I did right here on my cell phone. I got the information and I got the video. Super easy. The Health Channel app is here 24/7 in the palm of your hand. The free Health Channel app provides you with thousands of videos that offer the latest in health and wellness information directly from medical experts. Download the Health Channel app at the App Store and Google Play today. I'm Olga Villaverde, and welcome to our Broward County Back to School Town Hall. As this school year winds down for the winter break, many parents, caregivers, and educators are truly breathing a sigh of relief. We got through the first few months with in-person classes for some and continuing online education for others. And today we have three amazing experts to help us look back at these past few months and look ahead into the new year. Yes, the new year. We have Dr. Valerie Wanza. She is Chief School Performance and Accountability Officer at Broward County Public Schools. Dr. Wanza, love the sweater. Donna Toby, Lower School Director of NSU University School. Welcome. And Dr. Scarlett Constant, Pediatrician at Baptist Health South Florida. Welcome to all of you ladies. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Hi, thank you for having us.
Hello.
Great to have you. Now, before we get into our discussion regarding Broward County, I just want to remind our viewers, anyone watching, if you have a concern, if you have a question for our experts, please send them in as soon as possible right now, and we'll get to them throughout our live discussion, promise. So, Dr. Wanza, I'm going to start with you. How would you say it went? How did it go back in person classes and then as the week progressed? What kind of grade would you give Broward?
So I think we're averaging about a B plus.
Good.
It was very, yeah, you know, we have some lessons learned, but we're doing well and we're pleased with our progress.
And what would you say those lessons are that need to be learned? What were some of those early issues, if you will?
Okay, so the first thing I'll say is, you know, most people will remember that we actually started the school year August 19th, 100% remote. And we stayed remote until about the second week in October. So when our students came back to campus, it was really a therapeutic experience for the students as well as the adults on campus, because they too were really missing the students just as much as the students were missing being on campus. You know, we did have to spend some time learning some new routines, because obviously we have a mandatory mask or facial covering wearing mm-hmm. policy, obviously the whole physical distancing component, and really just teaching some new behaviors to students, because they were used to just running up hugging their friends and doing this, and no, yeah. We have some new protocols that we have to implement. And then once we came back on campus, and I'm sure we'll get into it, it was really the whole balance between teachers working with students in person as well as remotely. But I know we'll get to that a little bit down the way. But it's really been a pleasant experience for all. And we're just happy to get through this first half of the school year.
I actually would give it a B+. It doesn't sound too bad at all. Donna, let me ask you about NSU University School. How did the kids, educators, administrators work during the first initial months? I'm sure there was a lot of happiness. Any surprises?
Yeah. So I think the beginning of the year was a time of learning for everybody. We had been on remote last year from March 13th on, and we had made a decision pretty early on in the summer that we were going to try to go in person as much as possible. Because we're associated with Nova Southeastern University, we had the ability to utilize technology that the university was bringing in And so right from the get-go, we knew that we were going to have students in person as well as students that were remote. We started the year off with about 60% of our students in person.
Wow.
And along the way, they have been able to make changes to come in person if they wanted to. And we're up to about 82 or 83% in the lower school that are actually here in person. So for our teachers, again, the greatest challenge was learning how to teach with some students sitting right in front of them, as well as having some students online. But they did a phenomenal job, and we're really, really pleased with what we've seen happen.
That's great to hear. Dr. Constant, let me bring you in. One of the biggest concerns, obviously, for parents, caretakers, at the beginning of the school year was basically the COVID. Would the kids get it at school? Would the kids bring it home? But I think we learned a lot about that, and it was positive, right? That there was no spreading, if you will.
Exactly. It's been excellent. There hasn't been any on-campus transmission of COVID. There are isolated cases, absolutely, that continue to occur, but it has been shown that these children are not bringing it to the school and transmitting it to their peers, which is great news all around. And I think is very reassuring for those parents that have not chosen to go back to brick and mortar.
And let me piggyback on COVID now with you, Dr. Constant, because I have a viewer question here from Robert. And this is a fabulous question. Does the district state anticipate in the future mandatory COVID vaccination similar to the regular vaccines needed for my kid to go to school? Do you know the answer to that? Maybe you can give some insight, Dr. Constant?
Sure. Well, let me clarify. We don't have a mandate to get vaccinated. Vaccines are recommended. They are required to enter school, but there are exemptions. And so I don't think that you can actually mandate that a child gets a COVID vaccine to enter school, just like the flu vaccine is strongly recommended and is urged. But again, it's not mandated. So to answer the question, I don't think that that's something that could happen.
And as a parent, I'm going to actually follow up on Robert's question. And if a mom or a dad or caretaker comes in and says, Dr. Constant, what do you think? Should I give my child the COVID vaccine? I know you're going to get that question. What do you say?
Well, I'm already getting that question now every day. And, you know, I do recommend it because, you know, like I tell the families, we need to do whatever we can to protect ourselves and protect our community. And we can all agree that this has been a long, treacherous year. And if we don't want to live like this anymore and everybody wants to get back to normal and get back into the routine, well, I don't see any other way to do it than to protect yourself and get vaccinated, because COVID is not going to just go away and like poof into thin air, we're back to 100% normal. I mean, we are going to have to live with this virus lingering around us for a long time. And so we choose either, you know, stay at home and not go to school and fear the virus, or protect ourselves and move forward. So I suggest try to protect ourselves and move forward.
And Dr. Wanza, when the vaccine comes, and I know it's currently now being delivered in some places, but when we get obviously more volume, will parents still have the option of saying, you know, I know there's a vaccine, really don't want to give it to my child, still want to stay at home? Is that going to be an option for the future in the new year?
For parents to keep their children at home for schooling purposes?
Yes, ma'am.
So, thank you so much for that question. So actually, parents will get some type of notification via text, email, whatever is their preferred way of communication from the district later this evening, that we are starting to administer a second semester parent questionnaire to all parents. It went live tonight, but they'll get the notification later this evening, and I'm sure they'll start to see it in the morning. And yes, keeping students home for the second semester to participate in learning remotely is an option. However, for students who are struggling right now with remote learning, we will be strongly encouraging them to return their students to face-to-face learning for the second semester. But we do recognize that parents still need that choice for a variety of reasons.
Okay, and Don, I'd like you to chime in on this conversation as well regarding the vaccine, parents' concerns of giving it to their child or not. I know you're at a pretty good percentage in your school. I think you said somewhat of 82%, if I heard correctly.
Yes,
that but what are you hearing the parents and what are you hearing?
You know, we haven't had that many conversations with the parents regarding the vaccine at this point. Again, I think because so many of our parents are opting to come to school and we give them the option every 9 weeks of transferring in or out. So we've had some flexibility there for our families. I think, you know, it all depends on what happens and how comfortable they are. Again, in some cases, parents will say to me, what do you think I should do? And I always try to say to them, every child has their own situation. Some have extended family members that they're living with, and they're just not comfortable having the children here. And we're going to do our very best to educate them, whether or not they're here in person or they're remote.
Fantastic. I want to remind anyone watching out there, if you have a concern, if you have a comment, if you have a question for our experts, please let us know. You can just write it down in the comment section below and we'll get to it as soon as possible. Dr. Wanza, we've talked in the past regarding the mental health issues that have occurred because of this pandemic, the loneliness. So I guess in the last few months, I can only imagine you've seen a lot of that sense of belonging again, being with students, just how much it helps to socialize. Are you seeing that? And do you believe that'll help in terms of the mental health issues that we've seen in the past 8 to 9 months?
Yes. And, you know, I'll start by saying our school district has an entire mindfulness initiative that we launched a couple of years ago. And actually, we start each class session, whether it's remote or in person, with some kind of mindfulness, mental health connectivity exercise for our students and for our employees. We're fortunate in Broward County to not only be recipients of one of the state mental health grants, but also through the generosity and support of our voters, who actually passed a referendum a few years ago. We do have mental health professionals in every school where kids can reach out, families can reach out. We always like to tell parents, if you are in crisis outside of school hours, please dial 211 for immediate assistance. But we have all kinds of activities where we are continuing to keep our students connected, whether it is remotely or if they are in the school setting and they need access to mental health services. We do have mental health professionals on every single one of our campuses, and parents just need to reach out to the school. And I will just say this, I know we have to move, but I will just say this, the mental health connectivity is just as important for our employees as it is for our students and their families.
Mm-hmm. And could you explain why so?
Because the natural place for kids to be, students to be, is in the school setting. Teachers and school professionals, they want to be engaged with their children in the live school setting. And I think for us to literally, at least in Broward County, for the students to be out of the school setting from March to October, it became very mentally taxing on our employees who they live to see their kids. They live to interact with them physically and the interpersonal and the connectivity. And so that's why we did convert a number of activities to the remote setting, but we were certainly welcome to see the physical bodies back on campus for that live interaction that children and adults need for our own growth and development.
Absolutely. And Dr. Constant, for parents out there who are still concerned, and I understand their concern, what would you say in terms of now that we've seen there really hasn't been much of a spread in schools, like Dr. Wanza said, children need to go to school. What words of advice would you give those parents who want their child to have a normal life but are still hesitant?
Right. You know, I would tell them to have faith in their teachers and in their school administration. I would explain to them that the kids are safer than they've ever been. You know, we're not seeing sick kids. We're not seeing kids with common cold or flu or strep or COVID for that matter. And so to have faith in their system and give it a shot and send their kid to school, because it really makes a big difference. you see the difference. The kids are so happy. They're more engaged. They're enjoying themselves. They're on a schedule. They have a routine. And that is really important, especially for young children. So I tell parents all the time, have faith and stay safe, of course. You know, the idea is that we're a community and we're working together to keep this thing going. Because if you're irresponsible and if every family is just relaxed and gets into trouble, that's when you cause problems for students at school. So to keep this going, let's all work together and stay safe and send our kids to school.
And Dr. Wanza, I wanted to ask you a question. And Don, I am going to come to you after this regarding not only just the in-person, but remote learning. How are you handling both? There's still, you know, some struggles, if you will, when it comes to technology, people needing that help.
So we were very fortunate in Broward County Public Schools. We have issued over 130,000 devices to our students, grades PK through 12. We have definitely worked with our local internet providers for families who did not have internet for a number of reasons, because obviously what good is a device without the connectivity? In homes where it continued to be a challenge, the district actually purchased and delivered hotspots so that students could connect. And what I will say is we are still working with our students because we want the engagement. And so our teachers are working to keep that balance of engagement for students who are continuing to learn remotely as while they are simultaneously instructing students who are in the classroom. I want to commend all of our instructional personnel for all of the professional development that they have gone through to really make this as seamless as possible for students who are learning at home, as well as students who are in the classroom, and they're doing that simultaneously. We've purchased additional technology for classrooms in the form of cameras that help teachers move around the room to give them some ease so that they can interact with both groups of students with minimal interruption as possible. But we have also advised our parents, and we will continue to advise them, that regardless of the student's schooling option that the parents select, their district issued device they can keep for the remainder of the school year. And if they find that they need a device or technology assistance, call their local school. We have assistance for them.
And Donna, I know we talked a little bit about balancing that online and also at home. You said it was successful. What has worked? What has not? And it's got to make for some exhausted educators. Let's be honest.
Well, the teachers are working very, very hard, but I think that you know, as Dr. Wanza said, the teachers have done a tremendous amount of professional development. They were in our doors immediately after school ended in June and were learning about all the different tools that they can use. And they have been connecting the online students with the students that are here in school by putting them in breakout rooms together. And they've just had to become very, very creative. They've expanded the walls of the classroom by utilizing tools that they've maybe never used before, some virtual field trips. And you know, there's a tremendous amount of creativity going on and things that I believe we will continue to use even once the students are back in person all the time. It's just been a tremendous effort on the part of all the educators that are in the building. And I would say the parents also working with us and the students have risen to the challenge much better than you could ever anticipate little people being able to do.
Oh, that's fantastic. I want to get to school sports. I want to get to food insecurity. So I'm going to cover that real quick because there's so much to cover in such a short period of time. Food insecurity, a big problem. Pandemic has only made things worse. Let's be honest, for many students, these school meals are really what they depend on, main source of healthy food. So Dr. Wanza, let me start with you. How are schools staying on track with that?
So one of the things that we were fortunate in our school district, we actually have a grant from the federal government that allows us to provide all students with free breakfast and free lunch. And that is important, free breakfast and free lunch for all students. We also still have meal distributions for parents whose students are learning remotely so that they can still drive by the school and pick up meals. We do meal bundles. We have served millions upon millions of meals to our students and their families since school closed in March, and we will continue to do so. We even when the students left for Thanksgiving break, they left with bundles of about 17 meals to get them through the times that we are off. And we will continue to provide our meal distribution to students throughout this week. Parents just need to call their local school for pickup times, for what is actually available. And then I have to give a huge thank you to all of our community partners who actually partner with our schools, and they do food distributions, community-wide distributions at our schools at different times throughout the month. So we certainly thank all of our community partners for having food distribution pickups at our school, where they actually get beyond the school meals that the district provides. They get fresh produce, there's meat, there's dairy, and we are certainly thankful to all of our community partners who continue to do that with us on a monthly basis.
That is so heartwarming. Donna, can you chime in on this?
You know, for us, it's not been as much of an issue. We provide lunch for the children every single day. But we have not maybe had some of the needs that there might be in some other places.
All right. And Dr. Constant, again, the importance of nutrition for these children to keep them going, to keep them healthy, fresh, healthy meals. Imperative.
Absolutely. It's important for our immune system. It's important for brain development, especially in the young pre-pubertal children. And this is important also just for motivation and overall general health. So this is something that, you know, we found during the quote unquote quarantine time, a big decline in nutrition and the, and you know, we had a lot of snacking, we had a lot of patients that gained weight because people were scared to go outside and they were staying at home and munching and snacking and just home all day. So this is a great turnaround. Again, going back to school and having a schedule has allowed them to kind of get back into that routine of having regular meals and no more snacking because you're sitting around the house all day. And so this has been a really good, a positive impact on our pediatric population by far.
Speaking of sitting around the house all day, I want to turn to sports and physical education. Before I do that, I just want to remind anyone watching out there, if you have a question for our three experts, please send in your comments in our section below and we'll get to it immediately during this town hall. All right, so sports and PE. Dr. Wanza, what does it look like for next year? I can't believe we're finally saying next year. Thank you, Lord. So what does it look like for next year with sports at school and physical education?
Okay, so I'll start with physical education and then I'll move to sports if that's okay. So physical education, we began right away in the classroom settings once we returned back to on-campus instruction, and we will continue to offer physical education. Our PE teachers love being outside, the physical activity. Obviously, they're actually the physical distance the kids, and then we still provide the remote physical education for students who are continuing to learn remotely. But PE will continue. It is great for the kids to be outdoors, the fresh air. They can certainly do all the physical distancing, and PE isn't going away anytime soon. As far as athletics, we did restart with our fall athletics. We do know that there were a couple of instances where students were at some type of community event or something, and then we may have had to close down a sport or a practice or an activity for a brief period of time and then reinstitute the sport, the practice, the activity. Our activities department has some very, very, very strict protocols. All of the student athletes go through some type of health screening prior to practice each day. We have our athletic trainers and our health professionals there to assist us. We actually do weekly calls with a number of health professionals in our county so that we continue to plan for our athletic programs, but we will continue them. And when we have those, you know, brief incidents that we do have to address and respond to, we will do that. But we are excited that our athletic activities are continuing as well as our academic competitions as well.
Oh, that's great to hear. And Donna, what sports programs are still in place at NSU and how important are they to your students, which I believe they are so important?
Yeah, well, as the wife of an assistant athletic director for 40 something years, I know about athletics and how important it is. So in the lower school, we don't obviously field teams, but we have been doing PE regularly all the time. And our PE coaches have done a phenomenal job of doing, getting very, very creative, whether or not, for example, she has set up a very large screen so the students that are at home can be working with them as they're doing their activities. She's gotten very, very creative. Also, we do after-school activities. We have sports skills being developed through the after-school activities. And our upper school and middle school have gone to non-contact sports. Because we are part of the university, we do have to follow some of the regulations of the university. And so some of our contact sports were canceled this year, but our students are still getting lots of physical activity and are enjoying recess time every single day.
Oh, that's fantastic to hear. Dr. Constant, I was going to ask you about sports and PE, but I have a viewer question that I'm going to actually give to you. And it's a very good question because I know a lot of friends of mine who have this issue. And this viewer writes, my elderly parents live with us and my children interact with them every day. I'm afraid to send them to school. What are your thoughts there, Dr. Constant?
I know that is a really big problem that we see specific to our community, right? We have a very heavy Latin and Afro-Caribbean population, and we have second and third generation type of living. You know, it's very difficult. I think that you want to protect your parents. You want to protect the elderly population. You really do, especially if we all live together. But at the same time, you want what's best for your child. And I think right now, you know, there's less risk sending your child to school. As we've mentioned before, there's so many precautions in place and the kids are doing such a great job, like washing their hands and wearing their masks and remaining in their cohorts and not crossing with other students, that if you can assure that your child understands the responsibility and is safe and is only going to school and back, and you're eliminating any other type of, you know, risk factors, which, you know, of course, on the weekends and going out and going to Publix and things like that, we always have some risk factors. But I think that school should not be on the list of high risk activity. I think that they should certainly consider sending their kid to school and, you know, trying to practice safely in other areas to keep their parents safe.
Thank you, Doctor. We've got about 5 minutes left, and I have a few more things that I want to talk about, especially families with children with special needs. Dr. Wanza, pandemic really hit them hard as well. How are these kids reacting to being back, and what advice do you give to those who are still remote?
So our special needs students are no different than any of our other students. They are just as happy to be back in school, and they need to be in school. I can tell you that in our special needs classrooms, we have purchased differentiated personal protective equipment for our employees who work in those classrooms and those settings, understanding that some of our students are medically fragile and they may have more intense needs that really need to be attended to. One of the things that we do across all of our schools and in all of our classrooms, we do deep cleaning in all of our schools. We also e-mist and sanitize and clean daily as well as nightly throughout our schools. And I will tell you that we strongly encourage parents, if they have questions, call the school, speak with the school administration, speak with their ESE specialist to learn about the different and unique things that may be going on in the individual classroom of those students. But we have identified protocols that are a little bit more extensive in the classrooms of some of our students with special needs, because we recognize that some of them have some more unique medical conditions that we do need to be more mindful and prepared for.
That's fantastic. Donna, the same question to you. How is NSU University School working with teachers and parents to protect everyone's health there as well?
Yeah, I think we've clear communication with our parents has been really, really important. The university very early on established a task force of about 50 to 60 people, and they meet every Tuesday morning and they review all kinds of new data and information. So we've had that to be able to guide us. We've put a COVID coordinator in every department to be able to disseminate information. And again, our marketing communications department has done, I think, a really great job of keeping our families informed, and that's been really important. I think we've implemented very clear guidelines, and we make sure that everybody is following those guidelines. The cleaning of the facilities is very, very important so that people do feel safe. And things have gone, you know, I think really well as a result of everybody working together for the common good of the children.
And I want to bring you all together in the last 2 minutes that I have here for the town hall. Dr. Wanza, I'm going to start with you. Any final words of advice for parents regarding the new year? It's really nice to be saying 2021. So words of advice for them. And if they have any concerns, where should they go in terms of questions and calling?
So first off, any parents with questions or concerns, please call your child's school. Call your child's school, ask to speak with the principal, the assistant principal, call the school. That is your first call for help. Or just clarification. We do have a parent survey that is being administered. It's going to go live tonight, but we'll make the formal announcement tomorrow for parents to start to indicate what they are leaning toward for the second semester, whether they're going to send their children back to school or whether they're going to keep them in remote learning. However, if students are struggling in remote learning, you will receive some type of a conference with someone from the school, because we're going to strongly encourage you to send your students back to school for face-to-face learning. We have nurses, healthcare technicians in every school. We implement some very strict protocols as it relates to cleaning, physical distancing, mask wearing, facial covering, I should say, wearing. And then lastly, mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you, we welcome your students back. Your students are our baby, and we thank you for partnering with us in educating your children, but we certainly want to see our students and their families back on campus for the second semester, and we are prepared to serve them in the safest way possible.
And I know you mean that, Dr. Wanza. I have a few seconds, Dr. Constant, final words of advice?
Yes. We did a great job, or the schools, I should say, did a wonderful job getting the kids back in and keeping them safe and healthy. So parents, trust your administrators, trust your teachers, and have hope and send your kids back to school. I think it'll work out very well.
Fantastic. And Donna?
Well, we've already started we've been working on the calendar for next year, for 21-22, and we're putting as many events back on the calendar as possible, and we're keeping our fingers crossed that 21-22 will be a very, very different year for all of us. We just have to remain hopeful.
Hopeful. That's a wonderful word to end with. Thank you so much, ladies, for your time. I deeply appreciate it more than you know.
Thank you. Happy holidays
to all of you. And please, we want to remind you to tune in to our Miami-Dade County Back to School Town Hall. So it'll focus on Miami-Dade. That'll be this Wednesday, December 16th at 4 o'clock. Again, this Wednesday, December 16th at 4 o'clock. Thanks again for tuning in, as always, and thank you for supporting South Florida PBS and, of course, the Health Channel. Be safe and have a blessed day.